It's perfect.
It's just an unusual route to go that you wouldn't be expecting.
Yeah. I suppose I always thought about stuff like that. I mean, it's like when people talk about trying to separate the music from the musician or the art from the artist. Like, if you're in a band and you hear, like, let's say you are in Sisters of Mercy and someone plays this Meatloaf Bad Out of Hell album, right? Yeah. You listen to it and you go, like whatever, musically, it's not for me. It doesn't really.
No, but it could be something as simple as that's who I want my drums to sound with the bass.
For me, that's
exactly
always
that's,
the thing.
That's
like,
so.
Like, there's a particular producers get famous for a particular type of drum sound or something.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
Once they kind of lock into that, they're able to hear that drum sound in their head for their next album. So let's chase him down and let's see what he's able to do.
So after the Sisterhood debacle, there's a little kind of fun story of that, but it'll take too long. Hussey and Adams formed The Mission, and I love The Mission, I think they're brilliant.
Yeah.
Their output is far more quantity over quality if you compare it to Sisters of Mercy, but at least they're still, like, a few years ago, they were still releasing pretty good. Mm. The last album they released was good. There's a couple of good songs on it as well. Can't for the life of me remember the cover distinctively, but at least he's still putting out stuff. You know, a lot to be said for putting out stuff. You'll eventually get like a couple of albums good worth of stuff where it's not put out, and just because you had a fight with Warner or whatever like that. Warner seemed like a bag of bastards, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
Lovely now, probably.
Maybe.
But then all I ever hear is stories about Time Warner.
Dealing people.
And they wouldn't mind, but they were released in 97 from the contract, and he still to this day hasn't, I don't think, really put out anything.
Really?
Funny story about the guy you were just talking about, I think it's probably Ben Christo and Chris Catalyst play with them now. And they were also in Ghost.
Really?
Yeah.
They played in Ghost?
They were Ghost guitarists for a while. I don't know if, I don't think they still are. Maybe Chris is.
I don't know.
But that's a kind of brief little history of Sisters of Mercy. I do like Sisters of Mercy a lot. The reason I picked, like I said, that is that's the one song that...
That's our universal song, I think.
I would have heard in the 90s and just went, fuck me.
What is that? Yeah.
It's brilliant, and it's just so long, and it comes like the second part of it is just a nice rolling sort of long outro.
Yeah, it's that intro for me. That intro does it. It's just
the sound of it.
Yeah,
the sound of it. When you hear it, it gives me chills. It's still, I'll never get bored of that song. I know it's very obvious if you're.
And that actual drum sound we're talking about is just.
That's my biggest influence on drum sound. That's whenever I'm writing stuff, people like, stop putting live drums on that. I'm like, no, that's the sound they want. That barely no cymbals, just.
Mad punch.
Kick, snare, gated, and reverb. Yeah. Just that sound is that
into your brain,
and that is an absolute sound of pretty much nearly all the bands that we've picked now. So here's your next one.
My next one is Bauhaus.
You got to put them in.
Another obvious one.
Yeah, but you got to.
We have to set the stage. Set the stage.
Yeah, they're hugely important.
I don't know. I don't know about Bauhaus. I don't know.
As how you feel about them?
Yeah,
tell you how you feel about them. Isn't that grand?
Yeah,
but it's more one of those. They're like, if you had to say, they were like the Sex Pistols of it.
Yeah,
but obviously way better. But what I'm saying is, like, I do like Bauhaus, but I definitely don't go mad listen to full albums. And when I do, I'm like,
it's fine. I picked the song "In the Night" from the 1982 album "The Sky Has Gone Out." Now this would be considered probably the most experimental Bauhaus album. And there's an awful lot going on in this album.
That's what I did like about them.
Yeah, they were absolutely willing to bring new stuff in.
Yeah. Well, I can admit if it didn't work.
So they were originally named Bauhaus 1919 in reference to the opening year of the German art school, right? Mm. That's obviously who they're named after, is the Bauhaus School of Art. They broke up in 1983, and members went on to form Tones on Tail, and Love and Rockets.
Love and Rockets. I do like Love and Rockets. Poppier stuff. But.
Yeah. So they got back together again.
Also,
In 1998, they got back together again. And then they knocked it on the head. They got back together again in 2005. And then this year, 2019, they had another crack at it, and there was murder. Literal murder.
Literal murder.
Yeah. At one of the gigs. Did, yeah. He got pulled out, didn't he? Got pulled out by the promoters and the security guards.
What was that?
Someone threw something at him and he hit them with a brick or something. Something fucking, I can't remember.
I think that's fair.
I might be with him on it. I'm not entirely sure.
He also got really sick. He didn't have a banger, did he? Hit something.
I don't know. I don't know. He's fucking old enough, to be fair.
Peter Murphy was sick a while ago.
Yeah.
Quite sick. And, it wasn't cancer, was it? No.
Didn't take to the Robocop suit.
I think he had something bad with him, but he's recovered now anyway. And the videos look great, man.
Yeah.
Of the new, like, not the new stuff, but they're, Obviously, the first one that goes up is Bela Lugosi. Did the video, but like, yeah, he still looks great. They look great. They look.
He's wearing a lot of prosthetics and stuff like that now to look like Nosferatu, an awful lot. But they're famous for the Bowie cover Ziggy Stardust.
You can tell from early on he's a massive Bowie fan.
Yeah, and obviously Bela Lugosi's dead. Bela Lugosi's dead is off the first album. So one of the
that's probably considered like
that's the first their song. Goth song. Yeah, that's yeah, their Goth song. You know, song, yeah. One of the guys from Bauhaus, David J, he started a band with the comic book writer Alan Moore.
Really?
Yeah.
Didn't even know Alan Moore was in a comic book. A comic book? A comic book,
yeah.
Band.
Alan Moore has given loads of... he's been involved with loads of bands. He's often done like spoken word stuff. I think he might play a couple of instruments. But they started a band called The Sinister Ducks. I assume it's shite. I'm not even going looking for it. I'm fucking out. Alan Moore can just stay writing comics, although he's retired now.
He doesn't like the new Watchmen.
He series. Doesn't like anything.
I like the new Watchmen series.
I do not.
I really did. I've only watched two and I thought it was good.
I'm waiting. Something better happens soon. That's all I'll say.
I think it's setting itself up very nicely.
For what?
I don't know. Anyway.
More nothing.
That's enough Alan
Moore. Yeah. this song is mad weird. This song, I don't give a fuck what anybody says, this is a psychobilly song. This sounds like The Meteors. This is fucking 1982, and this sounds like The Meteors. The timing's roughly kind of right, but holy shit, like, it's got that kind of country and western rockabilly intro. It has this weird kind of walking bass line that's very, very rockabilly.
I love their bass lines. Yeah. I mean, like, Kick in the Eye bass line. Kick in the Eye is like a David Bowie disco song, and that's why I'm absolutely mad about it.
Like,
if you can make dark disco music,
exactly. Like this to me is this weird combination of like psychobilly and like proto indie music almost.
Yeah.
It sounds like Suede, right?
Suede would have definitely been influenced.
Yeah,
by
big
them.
Time.
Yeah.
Like there's a mad Suede feel to the kind of the swing of the song, but then it just goes back into this fucking Meteors, like this early psychobilly. It would have been like really popular in the kind of British music scene back then as well.
His solo stuff was very poppy as well. Cuts You Up and Strange Kind of Love and all, but they're great songs.
It's so fucking weird listening to this song, because I was going through that album, because I like the album a lot. I was going through and I was trying to pick something that wasn't like super obviously fucking goth. I mean, it's definitely a goth song, you know, it appeals to that.
Yeah.
It's on the fucking...
I can imagine if somehow half of these people were listening to this podcast because I shouldn't have been in that list.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Because like you said, it's not really a music
not
style.
Really. Not
it's
really.
Not a music style, really.
Absolutely. Like that, and the cover of it's gone out.
It's a ginormous umbrella term.
That's all it
for
is.
For so many
rock music.
Yeah,
exactly. But the cover to this album has to be one of the most famous kind of gothic-y album covers of all time. The Sky's Gone Out. It's just that big ring.
I was looking at, when you put up that picture of the album covers, I realised how many of the album covers are black and white.
Yeah. Just, it looks like just somebody made it.
It's just photocopied.
Exactly.
Yeah, a few times.
Yeah. Stupid, crappy zine from the 80s, photocopied a thousand times. Yeah.
It's classic.
Yeah,
post-punk 80s guys.
Exactly. I had to throw that Bauhaus in there. I think that in that song, there's much less punk than there will be in a couple of the other bands. I think this one is most definitely psychobilly or kind of neo-rockabilly influenced, and those genres would have been in their kind of birth around that time as well. Like, most certainly there would have been bands making waves in that scene, and that scene would have been so fucking small that I'm sure plenty of people and bands thought that they could have just lifted or cloned it to a degree without ever being spotted, you know, most certainly. Like, it's only years later that most of those kind of early psychobilly bands actually became popular.
It's a mad link do see some psychobilly bands and rockabilly having got aesthetics and music, and it does work, and it's probably the only way you'll ever get me to listen to those things.
Believe it or not, it tends to be more of the American psychobilly stuff,
and that's later. And it's hard to know because they're touching on horror stuff, which just looks like
They brought a lot more of that kind of goth aesthetic in. Like, the early psychobilly stuff was all colours, like green hair, yellow t-shirts, pink trousers.
And then you have to talk about the Cramps being a bridge between that as well.
100%. Anyway, who's your next one?
My next one is She Passed Away. The song is Kazleti Kutlama from 2010. These are kind of new kids on the block. Goth music. They are a Turkish band.
Really?
Yeah. formed in 2006, the labels that you'd attach to them would be like post-punk, dark wave. Yeah. The strange thing about them is they sing in Turkish. Even though both of them have been in bands that sang in English, they said that when they came to do this, they wanted to have this. So it's the music is kind of minimalist poems, they call it, minimalist poetry. So it's just very kind of, a lot of stuff was repeated over and over again. Yeah. So it has that. And the thing I love about them is just the style of music. It's kind of like throbbing bass with the synth lines are fantastic. The two guys that started were Volkan Kaner and Idris Akbulut. Now, the funny thing about that is he left in 2005 and I couldn't. There's still little on new bands, really, apart from the audience. So I find reading a lot of their interviews is only a real way to get more information about how they see their music or how they talk about it. Because I don't really want to look at the labels that like Wiki or just fucking even Spotify would give these bands. But one of them, the new guy that joined, I'm not going to try and pronounce that name. Doruk Ozakutakan.
Right.
He was their producer.
Yeah.
And he joined them. And he, I think someone in an interview said, he's kind of sound a bit like Sisters of Mercy. But yeah, we sound like Sisters of Mercy if the only goth band you know is Sisters of Mercy. Yeah. Which is kind of funny.
Yeah.
But then I read up that they had initially name checked Sisters of Mercy in their bio before he joined. So it's probably coming back to it. The bands that definitely influenced them were a Swiss band called Grauzone. So if you're a fan of She Passed Away and the German band DAF as well, that's where you can tell they really got their sound. But of course, Sisters of Mercy are a massive influence on them. You can tell it just by the deepness of his voice.
Yeah.
They have three albums. I'm going to try and attempt all three of them. Belirdi Geech Gek. Excuse me, I could be getting that all wrong. Narin Yal Yizlik, 2005. And their latest album is what we were just talking about earlier, a little bit darker kind of disco. It's called Disco Ankyset. And you know what? I'm definitely not getting them right. They are a relentless touring band. They're one of those bands that just want it now.
They're
gonna just go. Yeah. And they're pulling in crowds. They absolutely will. They did a gig with Drab Majesty, I think I mentioned that before. That ill fated for me because I couldn't go to it after buying tickets to it. But I really, really like this band. It's just so strange. A lot of our lyrics are, well, because they're in Turkish, so I had to kind of read up about what are they talking about. A lot of people were like, that's a very political place. Is your lyrics political? And they went, not really. It's more just how we feel living in Turkey, and the scene over there is in guts. There's not.
Really. Of course there's not.
They said the closest they would really get it when they moved to Istanbul. They had to move there because there was nothing in Bursa where they're from.
Yeah.
They were saying that the closest they can get is when an indie band would try something weird.
Really?
And they go, oh, that's a kind of weirdish indie band in Turkey like that. But yeah, I don't know. I don't know of any other Turkish.
I don't think I know any Turkish fans in general.
In general, yeah. So I guess they won't be touring with System of Down anyway. I'll tell you that. The Armenian.
it will not be happening.
No. So yeah, man, I like She Passed Away a lot. The new album is good, yeah. It's more stylish. You can tell a bit of production.
They rub some money on it.
It's a little bit dancier. They are making music that you can have a little bop to.
Of course.
Have a little gothy bop.
Little goth bop.
Who's your next one?
Little goth bop.
Goth bop.
goth boppy. Who do I pick? Skinny Puppy.
Oh, yeah.
So Skinny Puppy are most certainly not an actual goth band.
No, that's the bird of industrial, really.
Yeah. So,
But they're...
It's definitely gothic. You know what I mean? Like,
it's in this big lace umbrella that we're talking about.
Yeah. So they Skinny Puppy would have been like the biggest influence on Nine Inch Nails and Marilyn Manson later on, and like anybody who was kind of messing around with drum machines, synthesizers, and
basically distorted vocals. And basically the most kind of popular goth music now would be like EPM and stuff.
Yeah, exactly. Like this is definitely the beginning of that. So they formed in 1982 in Vancouver in Canada.
Yeah, a lot of people don't know that's Canadian. Yeah. Goths know everything about goths.
So they started off as a side project of another band called Images in Vogue. Now, I don't know anything about Images in Vogue. Couldn't tell you.
Yeah.
But they're known for like all their stage shows. They have these big, mad, elaborate stage shows. That's one of the things they're famous for. Like they completely commandeer a stage and fill it up with fucking bullshit. one of the big things that they do is they try to make all their music bring attention to like animal testing and chemical warfare, which is mad weird. Like,